can build a frame. So this is a coordinate frame, and even this one can consider the dual frame, which I will then continue. Dual frame. Sometimes people call it coframe. So it's the basis of one point, the point. Okay? And this kind of frame has this property that you prepare one vector of these two. Now, taking a function A, which goes from U to invertible and by n matrices, so it's a function that to every point associates an invertible A by A, and by n matrix copies A. So, taking such a function, one can construct new frames, say, in U to be a new of S. So this matrix is of this function. So there's a given a point, we go in here, there's an n by n matrix, which is invertible, so at every point we get this matrix. And if we just sum over mu, then we get a frame in mu, which is a new frame because this matrix is invertible. So if these vectors were linearly independent, then these vectors were linearly independent. And a coframe, so then associated with that, so this is new, associated with this. There is a dual frame.
Sorry, Powell. You use maybe the sum letter from this
yes.
one?
Yes. Call this maybe like this.
Okay. Just to.
I prefer it like this. Okay. So, and these frames, these in general, you know. Why everyone would do instead it's non-zero for some mu, for some mu, or even all. Okay. So frames for which these holes are called holonomic, and frames for which these holes are called unholonomic. Given a frame that's in mu, in general, frames are non-holonomic. If I didn't say that the frame is holonomic, it would be non-holonomic. Okay? So let E mu be a frame. That is corresponding dual frame. Object that will be really fundamental is rather dual frame than the frame.
Okay, so I will be always telling you how frame is changing when I'm talking about the change of a coframe. So if I have a coframe like this one, and then I define a new coframe by a mu e mu, and this implies that this guy changes. This when the coframe changes like this, so this function A enables you to pass from one coframe to another coframe. When it passes from one coframe to another coframe by this function, then the frame changes according to that. This is introduction. And now the main object will be just for today will be forms of presentation.
Something like it is
it has values in Rn, for example, this is b, and each of these components is a k4. So it has index a, b, where this a, so vector valued for this vector space is my Rn, so this index here a comes from 1 to n, such that this guy is a collection of k1 forms for each a.
Take as B
the same n as the dimension of my manifold. And I define now this form alpha, which will have n indices, mu, and I will define this form theta, because it's some canonical, so it will have first a letter associated to it. So this canonical vector valued one form, call it theta mu on m. So I want to know how to evaluate this form on a coframe. So by definition, I just say that it's just in U. So given a coframe in U, I have N1 forms. So theta mu evaluated on coframe E is just in U. As simple as that. Okay? So I define this guy. And now note that if I just take a new coframe, right? So it should be a coframe mu, right? But it's precisely a mu mu in U, and it's precisely representation rho of A acting on E mu, where rho of A is equal to A. So the representation here is just identity representation. So rho in this case is identity. And precisely I have this what I wanted, that my form theta with index evaluated AE is just rho times alpha of E with index. And that's precisely what it is. So this is and it's just God-given on any manifold. Second example is not that canonical, but you can always associate it. So I call it one form of type E, but I can also call it vector valued one form, because it has indices like a vector. It behaves like a vector. Right? So now, my second example, that X be associated to a vector field is again a vector valued form, zero form, if you will, which I define as vector field X acting on this frame mu, which is the same as this mu being evaluated. So now, this is a zero form, definitely, because it is just, this is a zero form with values in V being Rn. So here V again is Rn. And what is the zero form? And what is the representation? Essentially, X mu on AE, just take as X AE mu, which is the same as X on AE mu in mu. X doesn't act in functions, it only acts on forms. So this AE mu X on E mu, which is AE mu mu on X mu. And we see that again the representation is precisely as before, wrong way. So conclusion on these two examples. They say canonical form theta mu on every manifold, which is one form of that E, but also with a given vector field, if you have a given vector field associated to it, there is always a zero form now, also of type E, vector value zero form, which are essentially components of this vector field in the frame E. Perhaps the third one, just for introduced terminology, if I have, so here was V for N and rho was identity. Now if I take V equal all endomorphism for Rn
fancy way of saying that these are just n by n matrices or literally just r n square. So here the guys that I will be considering are guys with one index up, one index down, and so this might be. And now, as a presentation, I will take something that mathematicians call a joint representation, and how this acts. So, rho A on such tensor T, or such, is just A T, A to the minus 1. Or in indices, I would like to say that T mu mu of A E is equal to A mu alpha T alpha beta E A E minus 1 beta. Okay. So, as I said, I have a canonical one form, vector value, canonical vector value one form is a vector field because have always its components, which will be just zero forms of type int. Then I can have tensors, which will be zero terms of type rho r s. But I never, so here I just assume that these guys, that each guy here is just a zero form, just a function. But I could assume, for example, that it's a one form, two form, or seven form. And this will be just k forms which transform like tensors of a given type. So that's what I have now. So somehow, how can I produce more of these forms? So example four.
But sorry, Powell, but in the third example you gave the representation. What? Which is the tensor?
What? What? In which one?
In the third.
In the third.
You gave the representation, but which is the example? Which is
okay, the I'm only saying that there are such tensors. Okay. I essentially specialized this what I made here. So tensor with only two indices, one up, one down, only to introduce this term okay. that I call this representation a joint representation.
Okay, okay. No.
So the tensors with one index up, one index down, I'll be calling tensor of representation type up.
I just asked because in the previous you was explicit with the
individual. Yeah. So,
in this one, no.
No, because we encounter many tensors of this type, especially soon, but I just introduced these ones that are really canonical that you cannot avoid. They always are there. Others are just like made by humans, but this is given by God. You have a manifold. And this other is also given by God as only you have the vector field. Right? So now, suppose that you have alpha 1, f 4 of k 1 form of type rho 1. And suppose that you have alpha 2, k 2 form of type rho 2. So now what you do, you just take alpha 1 times wedge product with alpha 2. So if this has indices alpha 1 has index A1, this has alpha 2 has indices A2. So this guy will have like two indices A1 and A2, which will be alpha 1 A1 wedge alpha 2. A2, and so if this is a K form of type Rho1, this is a K2 form of type Rho2, then these fields will be K1 plus K2 form of representation type, which is just tensor product of these representations. Whatever it means, don't worry, it's just for those that would be worried if I can produce more. forms. So even this procedure, I can produce more forms starting from given ones. And all of this is needed for defining the main concept for next lecture, which is just covariant differentiation. So let's start with this, what I said before. So I have x, a vector field, built on M. And associated to this, there is zero form. It's mu of E, interest x on mu, defined like this. So these are just essentially components of this vector field in a frame E. And now, let's see. So this is a zero form of my coordinate, right? So if it is a zero form, so let's start with this guy in a different frame, and it's a zero form. So for every mu, it is a function. So applying on this function, I can apply the exterior derivative. I apply exterior derivative on this. So I have for every mu, I have a function. So d can produce a one form of every mu. So the question is, if this what I will get will be, so this will be a one form with indices mu. The problem is, if this will be a one form with this indices mu, that will have representation type rho equal identity. So you would like to have an operator that sends objects of type, given type, let's say k forms of the given type, to a k plus one forms of the same type, that the type is not changed. So let's see if such an object, for example, would be an exterior differential. So let's apply it to the definition. So this is this acting on A mu, x mu on E, right? So now if we just apply this, there will be just a term like x mu on E, x mu on E. I am applying slightly this rule that I was just defining last time. So now look. This term, so I would like that D applied on this would be again a one form now with index mu that transform like this guy was transformed. But it doesn't work because it has this bad term. So it's a good term here. And there is a term here that prevents this object to be a one form of type E. So somehow you see that if my goal is to find kind of differential operator that transforms k forms of a given type to k plus one forms of a given type, exterior differential is definitely not good, because already on zero forms it produces bad terms. So somehow, what to do? So I have to somehow try to find a definition, try to correct this operator in such a way that this what I get here will be one form of type identity, right? So that's the idea. So the goal here is to replace B by something more elaborate. So we change this guy to a different guy. So we now define D by D on its mean of E is as it was, but this will be not good if I want to achieve my goal, then it will be just of type E. So since I don't know what to do, I will add a new term, which I will call like this. So now I will be needing an object is doing this is mu and nulo, which depends on the frame, which corrects this by that. Okay? So this, so since this was a zero form, this is a one form, this is a zero form, so this should be just matrix of one forms, right? So I just, I don't know what this guy is, but I want to introduce this guy in such a way that when I transform it by two different frames, AE, then the omega transformation rule for omega mu nu e will follow from the requirement that d on x mean of a e is just a mu mu e on x mean. So simply, I know that this is bad, so I now define this with something which I don't know how to transform, but I want this transformation to be such that d of x mu on a times e A leads me on. Just like that. So let's see what we look at. D x mu on A B. By definition, because D x mu on A B plus omega mu on A B x mu on A B. This we already have, so it is something like A mu D x mu plus x mu e on e. And here we have omega mu nu a e times a nu rho e rho. That's what we have on the left hand side. On the right hand side, we have a mu nu e x mu of e plus omega mu rho of e x rho of e. Okay? So we have to compare this thing, so this is my left. Right. So we see that this term and this term are the same, and then three terms remain. Left equal to right. I put everything on one side, which will be on the left. So I will start with this term. So first of all, there's x rho here, there's x rho here. Good to make rho here and rho here, and yeah, that's right. So there will be x rho of e, and on this side will be omega mu mu a e a mu rho. With this term, then there will be minus this term from I, which is this one, and that will be this one here, plus the a mu rho. And this one is zero. That's what I did. If I just, so in matrix language, would be just like matrix omega A E is multiplied by matrix A minus matrix A is multiplied by matrix omega E, and then there is D of matrix A, and this must be multiplied by X rho, must be zero. It should be for any X, so therefore it must be zero. Which means that if A is function value in invertible matrices. So then if I multiply it by a to the minus 1, then I will get that omega a e is equal a omega e a to the minus 1 minus d a times a to the minus 1. And I get the transformation rule of this one form domain. Or if you prefer with indices, no problem. Just a mu from the draw in alpha alpha beta a minus 1 beta mu minus d a mu alpha a minus 1 alpha. Okay? So I define operator D, which now will transform zero form of type identity to one form of type, zero forms of type identity, to one form of type identity, like here, because of identity type, provided that I have objects which, when I change the frame, transforms like this. And now you see, this is something new in our scheme, because in our scheme, this thing, or this thing better to see, behaves like a tensor of type R. So it transforms like a tensor. But there's this inhomogeneous term that appears here. So it is something very different. It's not, these guys are not anymore forms of a given type. These are one form, but these are one forms that transforms badly. Things were like this, they would be just one form of type R, but they transform like this in a homogeneous way. So these are totally new objects from totally new scheme, and they need separate names. So you have tensors, you have these forms of type Rho, but now there are these one forms that transform like this, and these are new objects which are called affine connections. So that's how you approach.
So try to use one of these pieces, and then I will bring more.
So these guys, if they were like this, they would transform according to some representation. So I would say that they transform linearly, but because they have this inhomogeneous term, or something like, some people call it affine term, which is why this object is called affine connection, because it just, so definition, an affine is a map assigning field of one form omega omega e to each coupling e such that, and this object enables us to introduce a differential brings the k forms of a given type to k plus 1 forms of the same type. For example, d on this mu e is defined in terms of these objects. You need these objects, right? So the next step is a curvature. Explain the idea how curvature comes about in this context. If something transforms like a tensor, there's a particular, very important difference between objects that are tensorials and objects that are connections. If something is tensorial, it transforms linearly, for example, like this, meaning that if this object that transforms was zero in a given frame, it would be zero in any other frame, because zero by linear map goes always to zero. But with connections, it is not so obvious, because if connection is zero in some frame, in another frame it will be in general non-zero because of this. So connections are such guys. Tensors are nice objects, so this form of type Rho are nice they are zero at the given frame, they are given zero in any frame. So but these guys in general are not, right? So now the first question one can ask, so make first observation. So one can always find a frame in which omega frame E, in which omega at that point is equal to zero. Why? Because suppose that if omega at P is not zero, so take A times E and ask when I can make this zero, right? So by my transformation rule, just omega P minus 1 minus P A to the minus 1. So these values of A to P, these values of A to the minus 1 P, and this value of this form at point P, and it is at point P, right? So just multiply, so this is a matrix which is invertible, so I can always like, so this condition means that DAT is equal to AP omega P at P AP like this. Right? So if I, so the question is, if I can find AP such that if I can find a function, matrix valued function, that the point P satisfies this rule given this non-zero. Of course I can. For example, I can take A of P at point P equal identity matrix, and then its differential at this point must be equal precisely this thing. And if I just, this is given, I simply take my initial value for my function P going out of point P to be this, and it's just like, I can always satisfy it, just take this guy to be this, so I take, so it is my initial condition for finding this A. I say that A at P must be 1, and its derivative at P must be precisely this form. And I can always find such guy, then although this was non-zero, that in this frame, this is zero. So at every point, I can do it. So the first observation is here, that I can always find a frame in which omega at P is zero. So now, the question is, important question is, when I can find A as a function, goes zero everywhere, so obvious. So at this, so I know that always at a point I can put this omega to zero. Question is, can I put this omega to zero everywhere by change of frame? So let's see. Maybe it's impossible. Maybe I can only do it in the point. Or there will be some conditions on this omega that I can do. Right? So now I want zero. I hate this indices, so I don't write it that, right? So now if I just multiply it by A, then I also have the A. So that's the differential equation now. Before it was just at the point, but now it's a differential equation for a function A. So my A must satisfy this equation. So I see what are its consequences. So I just apply exterior derivative on both sides. Remember from my rules, and it was why I just put all these rules, how this exterior derivative works. So for example, D acting on here would be zero because D squared is zero. Here it would be DA, which is a one form. So it should be wedged, this omega B. And here we plus minus 1 to the degree of the form, but the form is just 0 form because they are functions. So this is just A, D, omega. omega e, right? But now my dA is just here, so I just put it there. So it is just A, pull out everything, d omega e plus omega e, which omega e. So this becomes so a necessary condition that I derived for omega to be transformable to zero in the entire region is that A times d omega e plus omega e west omega e must be zero, and this must be for any A. So actually not even for any A, but just now to the A to the minus one on this side, sorry. Not for any A, it's just what we say. And the necessary condition for this thing is that d omega of e plus omega e plus omega e must be necessarily zero. So if you give me these forms omega e that don't satisfy this condition, no way that you can remove, make it to zero in the neighborhood by a change of frame. So it is convenient to introduce omega of e to be precisely this. Or if you want these indices. And now some sort of miracle happens. First of all, bunching of this, so this was a one form. So this is a two-form, this is a two-form. So this is a two-form guy. This is a two-form guy. And this two-form guy must vanish for omega to have a chance to be gauged to zero by a choice of frame, right? But a miracle, a small miracle that happens here is that this guy is a connection, this guy is a connection, this is D of connection, and you combine these all together, this guy turns out to be a two-form of pi r. So it's a tensorial object. Somehow, naturally, tensorial object pops up by differentiating connection. So you just differentiate connection properly with some now quadratic correction term. Then although this object is a connection, this object is a tensor of type R, actually it's a two-form of type R. And the theorem, the Lett's theorem, a connection can be gauged to zero in the neighborhood. So summarizing the thing, I call usefulness of the subject, by connection usefulness, covariate exterior, which transforms K forms of type log to the component of type log. For example, if my row is just this row RS, or if these forms are just tensorial objects, then this object D, which applied on a form of type log RS, extended the formula that I made for D6 mu before. So that will be just A alpha A mu 1 alpha T alpha. And now minus E wedge omega of E wedge, and now minus omega of alpha mu 1 of E wedge T mu 1 mu r alpha mu s plus minus the omega alpha mu s of E T T mu 1 mu r mu 1 alpha E. Okay, so it's an exercise to check that is a correct definition that makes, that extends this differential that I just introduced for is mu. So the upper indices transform precisely as the 6 mu, and lower indices transform with minus sign like this. Okay? And you can check that. So one has to check that if you put A here and A here, but not down, then it's transformed properly. It requires to be checked, or there are some other methods to check it, but believe me, it is the correct definition. We have a connection, so first we have a frame, then to each frame we associate connections. Frames. Connections. Then we associate curvatures. Like this. And remember, I told you and I emphasized that on a given manifold, there's a God-given, vector-valued form, this theta mu. So, given M, we always canonical form theta mu. So now suppose that M is equipped with connection. So not on top of M, we just equip M with a connection. So it's a set of these omegas that transform properly. Okay? So associated with this connection, there is this covariant exterior derivative. And so one is immediately tempted. I have this guy given because I have a connection, and I have this guy not given. So what I will get if I just apply this guy, which is just ahead because I have a connection, and I have this God-given form of type E, each one form of type E, right? Then it will produce either is identically zero, which I doubt. Maybe there are such that it is zero, but maybe not. But if it is not zero, by my construction, this will be now a two form of type B. So call this two form of type B, which is called, so after writing the computed, so this guy theta mu is defined as D of theta mu D, or if I just apply this word theta mu there. Guy is called torsional. So if only I have a connection, I immediately have two tensorial objects associated with them, with the connection. Namely, its curvature, which was defined somewhere. I have a curvature omega. And I have this guy as well, immediately given, because theta is nothing put by hand, it's just always money. So connection somehow immediately defines two tensorial objects. One is curvature, the other is torsion. And now you know what does it mean that the curvature of a connection vanishes. If a curvature of a connection vanishes, then a connection can be gauged to zero, as it was. So we can always find a phrase in which a connection is zero, and then work in such phrase and expect to have no connection at all. So that's the first thing. Connection can always and also have torsion. And I developed here a calculus of forms which in particular behave like tensors. If I just specify special representations, it will be just tensor valued forms. But what if I was restricting myself only to the tensorial language, just not thinking about forms? So just if we just have tensors or tensors or tensor fields. So we have this T mu 1, mu r, mu 1, mu s, which transform like this, and for each value of this mu's and nu's, this has zero form. Zero form of time rho r s, right? So the tensor. So associated, if I just apply exterior, covariant exterior derivative, covariant exterior differential, which is just this D, as defined there, then I will have this guy, which will be, by my construction, one form of type rho rs. Okay. So now, if I have a vector field, x, I can just hook vector field with this one form. I stop writing this E. You remember that it depends on E. Just to make my notation less cumbersome, I will be forgetting about this E gradually. Okay? So I start with my zero form of type of tensorial type, then I produce by exterior covariant exterior differential one form of a tensorial type. And now if I just hook it with a vector field, there will be again zero form of the same type, because this hook will not destroy this property of transformation of the indices, because it doesn't get indices at all. So then this guy, people tend to denote like this. So this is, so and in this way I map this from tensors tensor fields of type proctor S. Again, so starting with a tensor field of type RS, it produces again zero form of the same type, which is just again tensor of type RS. So this thing is called, how this thing is called, Antonio?
Covariant derivative, no?
Covariant derivative. And of course you see that because this x is linear on this side, so this map is linear, so the alpha x plus beta y is just alpha dx plus beta dy, and is f linear. So, given this definition, what is this guy? Now, if you just take x t mu r mu 1 mu s, x can be written in a frame as its component. So then you can write it as x mu d mu. U1, U2, U1, U S, and this thing being mu of P is denoted by P of mu. So it's a covariant derivative in the direction of mu's vector of a frame. This thing is a covariant derivative of a tensor field in the direction of a vector field X, and this covariant derivative of tensor field P in the direction of a frame component mu and is denoted in mu. And now, if you have all this language like this, you can now try to calculate commutator. You can just apply this guy, for example, on a vector. Say you can calculate what is that on x stroke. Oh, something like this. You can calculate this with all of these definitions. And then you can try to relate this what happens here to because what's going on. This guy depends on the connection, so applying this on that, it will be just differentiating connection. So like this one is differentiating connection. And this one, because it is because these are two forms, so it is antisymmetric in a way. So somehow this guy should be related somehow to the commutator of this derivative. So somehow I developed calculus in terms of forms because I find it much easier to calculate and much easier to apply in general relativity. But people usually work in terms of these operators, or actually in terms of these operators. And I strongly recommend to switch to my computer. Okay.
I think that I should stop today because. So maybe I will tell you what I will be doing next time. So.
Maybe you have to say something about the future lecture.
Okay. First of all, why I needed all of this? Because I want to formulate, for example, theory of Newtonian space. In Newtonian space-time, there is gravity. And what is the very big difference between space-time with gravity and space-time without gravity? In space-time without gravity, we saw that these preferred motions were just free motions, right? Free motions. And since gravity, I would like to view also as no force, but something that belongs only to the geometry. So I would like to have some preferred curves in spacetime, which is supposed to describe gravity. And without gravity, we know that these free motions are just straight lines. And what we know about straight lines? Straight lines are such that if they were parallel at the very beginning, they will never meet, right? But if you just look at the simplest situation of a wavelength of particles Like suppose we have these two particles. There is Earth, and there is me jumps, right? So when me jumps, I go up and go down, and I want that this jump, like, or better, but yeah. I don't know. Better like this. You have here a trajectory of a bullet that goes on there. It's like shoom, like this, right? So it goes. That it starts from the earth. Maybe this is better. Starts from the earth and falls down in the earth. Okay. Starts from the earth and falls down in the earth. There's no other force but the gravity that I would like to attribute to the property of space. So if I just look at these trajectories of these two bodies, Earth and this point on the earth and my ball that is just going up and down, if I put them in space time, so they start at the same moment of time and then they start to go out from each other. They are just going out. They are here in the farthest possible thing, and after some time they fall down and they meet at the same point. So somehow the free fall of a particle going to the Earth and Earth to be going to the particle, which are just these preferred motions for which there is no any force, there are just free falls. And this word line of this particle started at the point and ends up in this point, and started at the point and ends up in this point. So these preferred motions, which are free motions, cannot be straight lines because they are just they focus after some time, right? So somehow if I want to incorporate gravity into space-time, then I should get rid the notion of straight lines. So somehow the notion of an affine space is too weak for such a thing. So I should have another notion of my. So now I want that my space-time will be not anymore affine space, but there will be a four-dimensional manifold. And on this four-dimensional manifold, there should be a structure that should distinguish certain class of curves, geometrically, that I will call free falls. And this additional structure, the simplest thing that comes to my mind, and actually not mine, but people discovered years before me, is that if you equip a manifold with a connection, then even a connection, you can define such preferred curves. And that's what I will be doing, trying to do next time. And I will be starting of incorporating gravity to the teaching. So that's the end of today. The point is that on Tuesday, the 1st of May, and next Friday, I won't be here. So the next lecture will be only on Tuesday, 8th of May.
Thank you.